And if you have your Bibles, I'd like you to turn to the book of Revelation, chapter 2. Book of Revelation, chapter 2. You're going to put up on the screen 1 Kings 21 first. But I'm asking them just to turn to Revelation 2. So you put up 1 Kings first, and then we'll jump right to Revelation. This sermon has been incubating for about a year, almost a year, a little less than a year. And it has been inspired by a number of things that have been stirring in my heart. And I want to present this message to you today. And I feel very strongly about the inspiration and the revelation of it. There is going to be a very strong urge on the part of some of you here today, after I get into the substance of this sermon, to get up and walk out. That's not a very good way to start a sermon, is it? But after I get into the substance of this sermon, that impulse is going to be there. It happens from time to time with other subjects as well. And the reason for that is that the spirit of Jezebel does not like to be tampered with, and I'm going to tamper with it today. The spirit of Jezebel does not want to be exposed for what it is. We're going to expose it today. Now, the spirit that I'm going to deal with is very real. It's very real, and today, especially today, it will offer resistance. There's going to be pushback to what I'm preaching during this sermon, during this service. And I just want to caution you not to give in to that urge. I want you to hear me out. Allow the Holy Spirit to accomplish His work in this service, and I'll define what I'm anticipating God will do here today. And again, I'm not trying to be theatrical, and I know this is a little bit of a dramatic way to start a message in a sermon, but what I need is I need your attention, and I need your attention throughout this entire message. One commentator wrote these words: "Without question, the nastiest, evil, most cunning and seductive spirit in Satan's hierarchy has to do with what many call the Jezebel spirit. This evil spirit has been responsible for not only tearing down churches and pastors and different Christian ministries, but it has also been responsible for breaking up many marriages and many friendships and many relationships. Now, there are a lot of dynamics that play out in church life. As believers, we become subject to a level of spiritual assault that we don't necessarily experience as sinners. As unbelievers, we are in captivity and we don't know it. We're bound, but we don't know it. We are Satan's property, occupied by him, but we're not aware of it. Ignorance can be bliss in some ways. But as born-again Christians, we become a target of hell. We experience spiritual assaults. We do that as individuals, as families. We do it as ministries within a church. And we experience demonic assault as a church, as a congregation, and as a Christian movement that has a worldwide influence. There is a demonically inspired hierarchy that operates, and those demons have names. They have names like fornication and rebellion and homosexuality and perversion and hatred and bitterness. These are distinct spiritual entities that are looking for individuals to occupy and then manifest themselves through. That's why certain people have a proclivity toward unforgiveness and bitterness, while someone else doesn't have any issue with that, but something else occupies. They may have an issue with avarice or greed, financial mismanagement, always skydiving into debt. That's a demonic personality that drives human behavior, and the objective is always the destruction of that individual. If the devil cannot take us fully back into captivity, he has a number of tactics that he employs whereby he can express himself in a Christian's life, in the life of a Christian family, in the atmosphere of a ministry or a church. This is something that as a pastor, I have to deal with. I deal with the spirit of Jezebel on a constant and a continual basis. And as I've been praying about this message over the last almost a year now, I've come to learn a lot about this as God has helped me, spoken to me, led me, guided me. I didn't feel a release to preach this sermon before this particular moment. I believe that it's going to be useful in advancing God's will. So let's be specific about what our objective is today. Our objective number one is for anyone here who has the spirit of Jezebel operating in your life, I want you to be able to recognize that and repent. Secondly, you may be in relationship with someone in whom a spirit of Jezebel is operating and it's wielding influence in your life. I want you to be able to recognize the spirit as it may be operating in another person's life or in the congregation itself, because I can assure you that the spirit of Jezebel is alive and well in the church. That's where it wants to manifest itself and express itself. So let's read our two texts. We find a woman named Jezebel in the Bible twice. And it just so happens they are relatives in the sense that they have a familiar spiritual dimension that is identifiable as the spirit of Jezebel. The first is in the Old Testament, 1 Kings 21:25. You can look up on the screens here just this one verse. But there was no one like Ahab. This is a fascinating scripture. There was no one like Ahab who sold himself to wickedness in the sight of the Lord because Jezebel, his wife, stirred him up. Powerful, incredible statement. And then we jump to the book of Revelation, one of the seven churches that Jesus wrote his letters to is the church at Thyatira. This is a direct address to the pastor of the church. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. He's talking to the pastor. Because you, he's talking to the pastor, allow that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. I want you to bow your heads. We need to pray and ask for special anointing today. Father, I pray for your grace to hold the attention of every believer in this assembly today. I take dominion over the Jezebel spirit from this moment forward. Lord, give me free rein to minister this message with authority, with revelation, with dominion, and with anointing. And let it resonate and let Jezebel be exposed here today. And let this spirit be banished from our midst. And we thank you for what you're doing in Jesus' name. So let's examine first of all the history that we have here. It's not a coincidence that we have these two narratives in the Bible describing these two women named Jezebel. The first is the wife of King Ahab of Israel, who is known, of course, as that one scripture that we read says, for his prolific wickedness. We find in the very beginning of his reign in 1 Kings chapter 16, and it came to pass, as though it had been a trivial thing for Ahab to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, that he took as a wife Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Sidonians. And he went and served Baal and worshipped him. So Jezebel is the daughter of a pagan king. This pagan king and the nation, the Sidonians, where she came from, are worshipers of a false god named Baal. And it was Jezebel, although we find references to Baal previous to this, it was Jezebel who established the Phoenician religion on a grand scale in the court of Abraham, of Abel rather. Her name, Jezebel, the name means Baal is exalted, and the other definition of her name is unchaste. She's the one who introduced Baal worship, as I said, on a grand scale, and used her sexuality to advance her will in Israel. She serves another god, and she has no moral boundaries. This woman uses her sexuality as an instrument to manipulate and to rule and to exercise witchcraft and to govern. One of her first acts, once she takes the position along Ahab's side as queen, was to massacre the prophets of the Lord. That reference is found in 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 4. For so it was, Jezebel massacred the prophets of the Lord. The spirit of Jezebel hates and despises godly authority. Wanted no one to be speaking for God. Jezebel wants control of the narrative. The spirit despises godly authority, and her first action was to rid the nation of the prophets. Of course, she wasn't successful because Elijah survived, and another several dozen prophets also survived. That was when they hid in caves and were fed and survived her wickedness. And there are other acts that Jezebel perpetrated that enable us to identify her spirit that we'll get to in a few moments. In the book of Revelation, we have another reference to Jezebel and another expression. So in the first reference, she's operating from the throne of Israel in a position of authority. In the second reference, now she's operating within the church under the oversight of the pastor, and she has free reign and is doing incalculable damage in our text. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you because you're allowing this woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. In this case, Jezebel has authority in the church to wield influence. Just like the Old Testament Jezebel, this spirit defies authority, does damage, and spreads wickedness through her immorality. As her name is defines her character, Jezebel has an unclean, authority-rejecting spirit. In the Old Testament, a king, Ahab, is under her thumb, as it were. You remember the Rolling Stones song, Under My Thumb? Well, that was a song written by Jezebel because that's where Ahab was located. There's a king under her influence. And under his oversight, she gains power and a platform to wield her influence. In the New Testament, she's operating under a pastor, but the pastor is allowing her to have her way in the church. And I love the phrasing of the scripture we read in 1 Kings. There was no one like Ahab who sold himself to wickedness in the sight of the Lord. So this man did bad things. He was an evil and a wicked king, but it says because his wife stirred him up. She was there behind the four walls of the palace, speaking to him, talking to him, agitating him, voicing rebellion, fomenting the worship of a false god, and this constant effort on her part to stir up her husband. We may have a different Ahab. Another translation says that he was incited by his wife Jezebel. In other words, he wouldn't have done what he did, but for his wife's influence. Jezebel was the driving force behind Ahab's wickedness and sin. And as I said, without him, we might have a different story and we might have a different Ahab. And as she was then, so the Spirit is today. It is the driving force behind much sin and rebellion in the church, especially as it pertains to rebellion against authority, sexual immorality, and idolatry. Now, the two accounts of this spirit at work, the one that I've referred to in the Old Testament and the one in the book of Revelation, take place hundreds of years apart. But they have very particular and very similar attributes. And I want to talk about three of them here today. I've already referred to this one, but I want to emphasize and underscore the point and add a little bit to it. Jezebel hates spiritual authority. In the Old Testament, she silences God's voice by massacring the prophets. In the New Testament, she wants to be God's voice. She calls herself a prophetess, and she's quite comfortable defying the pastor, defying truth and revelation, undermining authority. She gets herself in a position where she can teach and instruct. It doesn't have to be from the platform or from a Sunday school room, but through various ways of manipulation, she'll get a hook into various individuals, and those various individuals will become her pupils, and her primary objective is to defy and undermine ministry. She will put her word and her authority at the same level or above the pastor's. Through criticism of leadership, she will assign herself authority above God's ordained headship. This is what it means when it says that she calls herself a prophetess. It doesn't mean that she wears a badge or even literally says, "You're to address me as a prophet," but in how she acts, or he, it can be a man, the spirit of Jezebel can act in a man or a woman. But by virtue of defying God-ordained leadership, she's assigning herself a position at least alongside and usually above the authority of God-ordained leadership. Jezebel has no respect for the man of God. She has no respect for his ministry or the leadership or the headship or the word that he may minister. She justifies her position primarily through criticism, whereas others, a majority, who are right-spirited, revere the authority that God places on leaders, and they take it seriously. But a Jezebel spirit doesn't. A Jezebel spirit is comfortable getting you after a service and beginning to rip into the message, beginning to rip into the pastor directly sometimes. The Jezebel spirit will find fault with every sermon, with any expression of godly authority. And as I said, and I don't want women to think I'm picking on you, because a Jezebel spirit can operate in a man. It's gender neutral in some of its ways of expressing itself. Jezebel will never ask the pastor what he thinks, because she comes to despise his counsel. She has sat, or he has sat in his office perhaps, and had to hear things that agitated and contended with that Jezebel spirit. And because there's such vitriol for authority that doesn't comport with her will, she has no appetite. She or he can barely sit through a service, and they relish opportunities to walk out of a service and not listen. They struggle to sit still in a church service. Paul wrote about one of these individuals in 2 Timothy 4 and said, Alexander the coppersmith did me much harm. May the Lord repay him according to his works. You must also beware of him, for he has greatly resisted our words. So he's talking about someone from within that is operating with a Jezebel spirit, and they're doing damage by virtue of despising and resisting the word of God and God-ordained authority. I've known a lot of Alexander the coppersmiths, and so too have many of you who have operated within the church. And Paul took this personally. This individual had done him much harm. This is a Jezebel spirit that is seeking to strike out and undermine the Apostle Paul's ministry. Secondly, the second feature of Jezebel is that he or she is manipulative. Jezebel will not tolerate not getting her way. She will not be satisfied, and she will employ any means necessary that she sees fit, or he, in order to get his way. She will never surrender to the will of another if it contradicts her agenda. And Jezebel is a ruthless genius, actually, because he or she, not surrendered to the will of God or the will of another, can make things happen through manipulation and witchcraft. We have the story of Naboth. Remember, Naboth owned a piece of property up against King Ahab's palace. And King Ahab quite fancied taking possession of this piece of property. So he approaches Naboth and said, I'll buy it. I'll trade you another piece of land for it. But I want that property. And Naboth said, it's not mine to give. And it wasn't. Naboth was a steward of that property. It was a heritage. It had been passed down. It was to be used for the benefit of community. And so Naboth said, Ahab, I don't have authority. It's not mine. I'm only a steward. And so the Bible says that Ahab sulked, he's upset, he goes into his bed chamber, and he's depressed. Jezebel goes in and sees him, he's acting out of the ordinary. What's wrong? He's told her what happened. And then Jezebel, his wife, said, exercise authority over Israel. Arise, eat food. Let your heart be cheerful. I will give you the vineyard of Naboth, the Jezreelite. She doesn't even know Naboth, but she's already concocted a plan and a scheme in order to extract that piece of property from Naboth and give it to herself and her husband. Ahab is willing to let this go. He's going to whine and sulk and cry and whimper and babble for a few days, perhaps. He'll get over it and he'll move on. Not Jezebel. No. Jezebel doesn't get over stuff like this. So she plots. When Jezebel's will is frustrated, she can't let it go. She has to take action. And so this spirit, in a man or a woman, will plot, will scheme. It has no morality or boundaries. It doesn't care who is hurt or the extremes that she has to go. She's going to get her way. And so she concocted a plan to have a feast made for Naboth and then bring in two scoundrels who will bear witness against him, saying, we heard this man blaspheme God and the king. And then when the people will hear those accusations against Naboth, they're going to drag him out and kill him. And then Ahab can take possession. This woman's a ruthless genius. She's able to control events. She stirs up her husband. She incites him. She agitates him. She pushes him. She drives him until the husband can't take it anymore and does her bidding. And then when Jezebel's ability to manipulate events is frustrated, they leave. This is what happens in a church. And they'll go into another arena. I think we have frustrated a lot of Jezebels around here. Not everyone who leaves the church is a Jezebel-spirited person. But what a Jezebel-spirited person will do when they can't manipulate within the confines here, or they have a pastor, or there's people that resist her tactics, then they will get away from whatever authority that they cannot defy and overcome, or will not yield to their manipulative tactics. This explains why Jezebel leaves the church. She can't maneuver anymore. And then the third way that Jezebel expresses herself is through her sexuality. Sexuality projected in private in the home between a husband and a wife in a very confined space like a bedroom is totally appropriate. That's where women should project their sexuality. Sexuality projected in a public arena is completely different. And the question is why? I've had incidences, a few of them over the last years, where a mother told their daughter, an unsaved mother told their daughter, and another one was some colleague at work. If you've got it, baby, show it. Now, why? Why would a mother or a friend encourage you to project yourself sexually in a public arena? Jehu. This is a fascinating part of the narrative of Ahab and Jezebel. Jehu is anointed by God, by the prophet, to judge the house of Ahab. Ahab has been killed in battle by this time. Jezebel is still alive. And so Jehu comes to town. His intention is to judge the house of Ahab. Now listen to this. Now when Jehu had come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it, and she put paint on her eyes, adorned her head, and looked through the window. So Jehu's coming. She's going to project herself onto Jehu in a sexually alluring way in hopes of manipulating him, getting him to calm down. She knows what he's coming for. Everybody does. She tries to sexualize the atmosphere. This tells you what her default mechanism was. It's how she projected herself. And while a Jezebel spirit can be projected through a man or a woman, this particular feature of the Jezebel spirit is solely the forte of women. Remember what Jezebel's name means, unchaste. This is her character. That word unchaste means relating to or engaging in sexual activity, especially of an illicit or of an extramarital nature. So when a wife projects herself in a sexually alluring way in a public arena, short skirts, shoulder, skin revealing type of garments, 6-inch high heels where you cannot walk normally. The way you walk in those kind of heels draws attention to yourself. That's why women dress like that on street corners. You don't have to talk to them to know what they're all about. And Jezebel will not permit criticism of a publicly presented sexual expression. You criticize women about how they dress when they're dressed inappropriately, they'll come at you with two things. If it's a man, they'll accuse you of being a pervert. If it's a woman, they'll accuse you of just being jealous. Because the Jezebel spirit wants to electrify an atmosphere with sexuality, especially in the church, because it keeps alive a spirit of fornication and a spirit of immorality. Somebody may not be thinking sexual until they come to church. And then they see the atmosphere is sexualized. It's my responsibility, the responsibility of the staff, your responsibility, and the responsibility of chaste women here to deal with that. If you see a woman dressed immorally and inappropriately, projecting herself in a sexual way, women have more sexual parts to their bodies. Tight clothing, showing skin, has a sexual component to it. Men generally can't come to church dressed in any kind of a way like that, and they don't anyway. It's a woman's, unless you've got more problems than I can deal with here today. And the objective with the New Testament Jezebel is to take hypersexuality, bring it into the church. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. This is to the church. Because you allow that woman Jezebel. In other words, the pastor's not ignorant of this. He sees. He's got eyes, got ears. He knows. He's aware. Because you allow that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and to eat things sacrificed to idols. That word teach means to hold discourse with others in order to instruct. That's what Jezebel does. She wants to position herself as a teacher or an instructor, and she'll get a hook into your heart so you'll listen to her by flattery. She's the only one who understands me. She really likes me. She compliments me, and nobody else does. And she will get herself, remember, it's a spirit that's driving her agenda. She wants to be in a position to begin to instruct and to begin to teach and to begin to project her anti-godly authority, sexual expression, publicly agenda onto her pupils and her students. This is how you end up in the church with unrepentant fornicators, people who indulge in pornography. So let's look at the effects of this spirit. Two accounts, Old Testament, New Testament, hundreds of years apart, the purpose is to disrupt and to undermine the work of God. In the Old Testament, as I said, it targeted the nation of Israel through the office of the king. In the New Testament, it targets the priesthood. It targets rather the church under the oversight of the pastor. In other words, this spirit wants to function in such a way that the pastor won't do anything about it. And I'll explain why that happens in a moment. And it's not an exaggeration to say that a church or a ministry or a work of God can be destroyed. You get a Jezebel spirit in a pioneer work, it won't grow. People may come and get saved, they won't stay. And it has the ability to come into a larger setting like this that already has a worldwide influence and ongoing ministry and work subtly behind the scenes to undermine and to defy and to work against what God is trying to accomplish. This is exactly what's at stake with the church at Thyatira. It's very evident by the harsh rhetoric that Jesus uses beyond where I read in the text this church is under the possibility of being destroyed. He says to them, you repent or else I'm going to remove my candlestick. And if the Jezebel spirit is allowed to run its course and then gain dominion, at the very least it will frustrate the work of God and discourage people and foment rebellion in a segment of a congregation through the influence of the authority-defying Jezebel spirit, and that will diminish the impact that God intends to have in the church. So I want to talk about four effects of the Jezebel spirit. And we need to look at the story of Jezebel's interaction with the great man of God, Elijah. Elijah has survived. When Jezebel massacred the prophets, she has survived. But Elijah set himself up to do battle with Jezebel. He's going to resist her. His objective is to rid Israel of the idolatry that she had introduced. And so remember the story of how he challenged the 400 prophets of Baal. You come, I'll come, we'll each build an altar and let the God who answers by fire be the true and living God. And so the 400 prophets of Baal build an altar. They call on their God. They cut themselves with stones. They go from sun up late into the day and they can't get anything going because their God has no ears. He's a false God. And then Elijah pours water on his altar as though it's making it hard for God. And of course, God answers by fire. And then the 400 prophets of Baal are slain. The 400 prophets of Baal are Jezebel's power base. They are all slain. When Jezebel gets wind of this, I think that Elijah thought Jezebel's going to repent and say how sorry she is. Here he has stripped her of her power base. She has nothing left as far as a base of support from anything like a priesthood. But not even Elijah understood what he was dealing with when he was dealing with the Jezebel spirit. He had a lot to learn about this spirit. 1 Kings 19 says Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, how he had executed the prophets with a sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as one of them by tomorrow about this time. So the first reaction to the Jezebel spirit we have here is fear. And I can tell you, I have felt this under the influence of a Jezebel spirit. Jezebel is not intimidated by the man of God. She's not. She doesn't miss a beat in our text. 400 prophets of her slain. She must have heard about how it happened. Ahab has some godly instincts, at least, has known about the God of Israel, answered by fire, burned up the altar by a miracle. She is not impressed at all. She's unintimidated because Jezebel will never be intimidated. She will always strive to intimidate. She will always position herself in that way. She has the ability, listen to me very carefully. Jezebel has the ability to strike fear in the man of God. Look what Elijah is reduced to. Running from fear from a threat that comes from a woman. In Revelation, we're dealing with a pastor who is afraid to confront Jezebel and her immorality and her rebellion. This is a word in Revelation, as I've said, it's a word of rebuke to this pastor because he's not ignorant. Jesus said, you allow that woman Jezebel. Why did he allow it? Because he's afraid to confront that spirit. Whenever a pastor or someone is afraid to confront someone over a legitimate issue for fear of how they might react, you're dealing with a Jezebel spirit. You may not understand what I just said. A pastor would understand it, and maybe you do. You're dealing with a spirit that is trying to intimidate you so that you won't deal with it. As I said, Jezebel doesn't want to be messed with. She can't be trifled with, or he. The spirit of Jezebel depends on her ability to intimidate. That's why women rise up when you challenge how they dress, if they're dressing in a sexually provocative way. Jezebel, not intimidated by your word of correction. Doesn't care if it comes from the man of God, she's going to manifest. She depends on her ability to intimidate because it gives her free rein as long as no one has the courage to confront her. This could have been what Timothy was dealing with. We've been studying the book of Timothy in our serious men's class. It could have been what Timothy was dealing with when Paul wrote to Timothy and said, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. We don't know what Timothy was dealing with, but it may very well have been a spirit of Jezebel in the congregation that was intimidating him. And because of that, he was not projecting his ministry appropriately. In order to intimidate, Jezebel will sow the seeds of false accusation. That's what she did with Naboth. She falsely accused him. A Jezebel spirit as a tactic of trying to intimidate you and get control of the arena will try and make you feel guilty about something, even if she has to invent it or make it up. She'll make up an offense when there isn't one. It's an accusing spirit. You did this, you said this, and the person who you're accusing will say, what are you talking about? That's not even close to being true. But they do that as a tactic. It gives them the high ground, they think. So it manifests itself by fear, and secondly, by isolation. Elijah decides that by isolating himself, he's taking the best option. But what is he isolating himself from? Obviously, he thinks he's isolating himself from Jezebel and her threat. And he thinks if I go this distance, which was quite a distance that he went into the wilderness, and hide in this cave, Jezebel can't get to me. But he's also isolating himself from his God-ordained position of ministry. The Bible says in chapter 19, verse 9, there he went into a cave, spent the night. The word of the Lord came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I've been zealous for the Lord of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. A Jezebel spirit will sow confusion in the man of God sometimes, where you don't know what to do and you draw wrong conclusions about life. The Jezebel spirit has the power to dictate actions. That's what's happening. We're talking about a man of God here. We're talking about Elijah. Powerful man of God, powerful prophet, powerful miracles, powerful authority, and he's reduced to fear and running for his life and isolating himself and detaching himself from the location and the place where his ministry should be carried out. And he's making these wild statements. I alone am left. Not true, God said. I have 7,000 others besides you. And there's other forms besides going into a cave. I've seen pastors and leaders and people, husbands or wives, when a Jezebel spirit is operating in the home, they just isolate themselves. They'll spend as much time away from home as possible. They'll build other meaningful relationships in their life. They don't have meaningful time with their husband. They're just ships passing in the night, but they have connections that they make outside the home that are more meaningful to them than their own wife or their own husband. A pastor can isolate himself from people. He's not answering his phone. He doesn't want to counsel. I've seen this take place and transpire. The third way that it manifests itself is exhaustion and depression. This is what happens when you're dealing with a Jezebel spirit. You're not willing to surrender to it, as Elijah wasn't. Totally, he did confront, but he didn't confront it unto victory. He's running, he's hiding, he's scared, he's tormented, and this breeds an exhaustion. He's worn out, and he's depressed. I remember a number of years ago, I don't think Pastor Mitchell would mind me saying this, but we were dealing with a rebel in our fellowship who we had a lot of concern about his ability to pull a whole segment of our fellowship out along with churches and pastors. And I was called into the trailer with a number of the other leaders to pray for him. Couldn't sleep at night. Couldn't focus. Agitated, upset. That's Jezebel. That's a Jezebel spirit that is at work to torment. Can't focus. Demoralized, discouraged. When you're trying to get dominion over a Jezebel spirit, it will wear you out. The energy that I need to overcome this spirit comes to a large degree in my prayer life and in my devotional Bible reading. That's where I get the fortification and the wisdom and the ability and the courage and the strength that I need in order to confront this spirit. And this exhaustion is followed by depression. Elijah said, prayed rather, that he might die and said, "It is enough now, Lord. Take my life, for I am no better than my father's." When we entertain thoughts of quitting, giving up, leaving the church, even the extremes of suicide or a death wish, as we see Elijah exhibiting here, it's evidence of the fruit of a Jezebel spirit. Moses, Jeremiah, Jonah, Elijah, all dealt with strong impulse and urge to quit, didn't they? All of them wanted out. They got tired of dealing with this. It's wearying. It's depressing. This defying, rebellious, sexually immoral, resistant spirit. Even if nothing's being said, it's out there. So let me talk about deliverance from the Jezebel spirit. So what do we do about this? This is a spirit that must be confronted. The problem with Ahab, to some degree Elijah, and the problem with the pastor at the church at Thyatira is that they were afraid to confront this spirit. Jezebel, as I said in the beginning of my message, doesn't like to be confronted, doesn't want to be exposed. That's why right now as I'm preaching, I'm feeling what I'm feeling. Jehu comes along. He's not amused by Jezebel. He's not intimidated by her. He's not afraid of her. When he comes along and she peeks out the window and she's all dolled up, he judges her immediately and moves on. He understood this spirit cannot be allowed to continue to live. It has to be judged. We can't allow it to continue to operate from the throne of Israel, and we can't allow it to continue to operate under the oversight of a pastor in a church. That's why Jesus addresses this the way that he did. Jezebel was alive and well in the church at Thyatira, and Jesus now is writing this letter and making an open declaration. This has got to stop. And the first effort was to give opportunity for Jezebel to repent. They rarely do, but the opportunity is afforded because God is a God of love and hope and redemption. If you recognize that there is in your heart a spirit of Jezebel operating, this altar is awaiting you to repent and get your heart right. If you have an authority-defying spirit, if you have a spirit that wants to take the normal practice of expressing sexuality from the bedroom out into the public arena, something is compelling you to do that. There's grace and opportunity to help you. But at the very least, the spirit of Jezebel needs to be recognized, and I'm preaching this not for the benefit of pastors. I'll be preaching this in conferences and discipleship classes and area-wide rallies, but it's for the benefit of the members of a congregation that you need to recognize this. You may be under the influence right now of a Jezebel spirit. You're emotionally invested in the relationship, and so you may very well defy everything I'm preaching and dismiss it. How you handle the Jezebel spirit when it's operating in someone around you is critical. It can manifest itself in a family as it did with Ahab. Jezebel stirred up Ahab, and it produced even a greater level of wickedness and sin that would have operated. I've seen wives and husbands stir their spouses up to rebellion. They're rebellious. They don't like, they're agitated, and they will project that onto their spouse where they wouldn't go in that direction, but for you stirring them up. When your husband is wrong, when your wife is wrong, and you can detect a Jezebel spirit, you have to lovingly but firmly push back and say no. Not in this house, not in my ears. When it's manifesting itself in a brother or sister in the church, the Bible gives us clear instruction. Now I urge you, brethren, Romans 16:17, note those who cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which you learned, and avoid them. Titus says, rebuke them sharply. The point is that whether you note them, avoid them, or rebuke them, the point in all this is that you can't be indifferent, and you need to be discerning about your relationships, and you need to recognize this. Action is required, not only by the pastor, but by the members of the church, by you. And many believers are challenged to judge in this area. But clearly the appeal is for you to be discerning about your relationships. Jezebel uses flattery. She knows how to manipulate her way into, or his way into, a position to get you to be her student, so that she can begin to voice her rebellion, begin to encourage you to project yourself sexually, or however she may manifest herself. So how do you handle this when it's operating in your own life? Verse 21, I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not. Now that's true with everyone. God gives people time to repent. They may or may not. But in this is specific. This is a specific effort on God's part to expose the Jezebel spirit to the point where the person who has it can recognize it and say, I need to repent. God's giving you space, and God's giving you time for that. If there is no repentance, then a person with a Jezebel spirit cannot be given a place of ministry or influence in the church. And if a person who has a Jezebel spirit is recognized after the fact that they're in ministry, they have to be removed from the ministry. That would be the pastor's and the leader's responsibility. You need to detach from anyone with a Jezebel spirit having influence in your life. As I said, people make incredible blunders with their relationships. They fall into the spider web of Jezebel and allow her to wield influence. You're made to think that having your wagon hitched to someone with a Jezebel spirit is a good thing, but what's happening is that your soul is being eaten alive by her. And ultimately, the effort needs to be made by the leadership and by the church to expel this spirit from our lives, from the church. And that's what we're going to strive to achieve at this altar here this morning. I want every head bowed and every eye closed. Nobody moving around, please. This is holy ground right now. We need an altar. Whether you're bound by the Spirit, or you're going to be one who is going to position yourself to be right with God and be a help in judging this spirit lovingly but firmly and praying it out of our church and out of our lives, we all are going to need an altar. We're not going to sing. We're going to have the piano music. We're going to have a church-wide altar call here today that you'll have the opportunity to respond to. Jezebel doesn't like to be messed with. I'm sure the urge to walk out has been rife this morning with some. I wouldn't know who necessarily, but with some. I know the Spirit. The best course of action, if you have a Jezebel spirit, is to repent. There's no advantage in holding your ground, continuing to attack and rebel the man of God against. Our heads are bowed. We have a lot to deal with. But first of all, maybe you've come to church. I know this is a little bit of a different kind of a message. I don't know if there's any very many churches that you'd hear a sermon like this. But I did feel inspired. But nevertheless, there are people here that you're not saved. You're not right with God. You don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. But you do know you need to repent. You're not right. Forget everything I've just said, preached on. You need Jesus because you're a sinner. I was and am without him. It's only him, Jesus, that makes a difference in my life. I'm not better because I got my act together. I'm a better man because I gave my life to Christ. And I was forgiven of my sins. And he made me into the man, the father, the husband, the grandfather that I am. If there's anything good in me, it's because of him. And as our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed, you know that's what you need. You need Jesus. You need forgiveness. You know there's something desperately wrong. You're empty. You're lonely. You're broken. You're crushed. You're wounded in life, betrayed. You've loved and been rejected. You're a mess on the inside. That's what happens in sin. This is a tough world to live in. It's hostile. It'll chew you up, spit you out, and not even know you've lived. But Jesus is here to forgive your sin. If you'll be willing to make him Lord of your life and acknowledge your sin and say, Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for my sin. I'm sorry for all the wrong I've ever done. I know it's me. I've done it. I made my decisions, but I want to repent and I want to get my heart right and I want to serve God now. Would you please help me and pray for me? I would be honored if you would let me pray for you. And in order to do that, while every head is bowed and every eye is closed, I would like you to lift your hand right now. Lift your hand. God bless you. I see that. Thank you very much. Anyone else? You'd lift your hand right up. God bless you. Thank you. See those two hands there, right here. Anyone else? You can put it down, son. Thank you very much. Anyone else? Thank you. God bless you. Anyone else? Lift your hand right up. God bless you. Anyone else? You can put it down. Thank you. Anyone else? You'd lift your hand right up. I need Jesus. I'm ready to repent. I want to get my heart right with God. Please help me and pray for me in Jesus' name. Lift your hand right up all over this building. Maybe you're backslidden. You're away from God. You know you've done wrong and been wrong. You're not moving in the right direction. You need to repent. Rededicate your life to Jesus. You can do that now. Would you lift your hand up right now? Lift it high. There's nothing to be ashamed of. You need to be honest with God about the condition of your heart. Lift your hand right up in Jesus' name. Jezebel is a convert-destroying spirit. It's an altar call-resisting spirit. I have to fight through that spirit nearly every single altar call. People that want to respond and they're not, need to respond and they're struggling. There's others here. I know there are. You need to lift your hand. I want to get right. I'm ready to make a decision. I need forgiveness. I need God's grace to work in my life. Amen. God bless you. Anyone else? Thank you. Way over here on my right, over there. All right. Amen. Okay. If you raised your hand, did you mean that? I want you to look at me if you raised your hand. If you raised your hand, did you mean that? I believe you did over here. You meant that, didn't you? I believe you did. Amen. I want you to come right now. You guys meant that. I want you to come. Here on my right, way over there. Yes, amen. You come. God's going to help you. Sinners getting saved by God's grace. Thank you. Thank you. Over here, there was someone else. Ernie, right to your right there. The brother, no, I said right to your right. There, he raised his hand. Amen. Thank you. God bless you, guys. God bless you. Thank you. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank you, Lord, for your presence, for your power. Jesus Christ has dominion over Jezebel, over the Jezebel spirit. That is what I contend for. That is what I depend upon. That's what's projected in the Word of God in the book of Revelation. I preach this sermon for the purpose of inspiring dominion over this spirit. Wherever it's detected, it'll be challenged. You need to challenge it. You're the one, some of you, under the influence of a Jezebel spirit. Right now, you're trying to justify the relationship, but I'm exposing it. You can defy if you choose, but as I said, ultimately, it's going to eat your soul alive. Why is it that you're not praying then and reading your Bible? A Jezebel spirit doesn't inspire an appetite for God's word and prayer. Doesn't inspire an appetite for obedience and righteousness. It inspires an appetite for projecting sexuality and rebellion. So there are people here. This is a tough call. I gave her space to repent and she would not. That's probably what happens in most cases when someone is bound by a Jezebel spirit. My prayer and hope is that God would be able to use me this morning to speak and preach clearly enough so that if you're honest with God and you want his best for your life, you'd be willing to recognize if there is a Jezebel spirit and say, I'm going to repent today. God's giving me this sacred opportunity and I'm taking advantage. I don't want any part of this anymore in my life. And it could be a man or a woman. You default toward rebellion and you try to solicit others in your rebellion. Jezebel isn't satisfied to function alone. She needs to teach. She wants to instruct. She wants to evangelize her spirit on others. And maybe you recognize this spirit in a relationship. Somebody you're hanging around with. You've gotten addicted to this relationship. It's toxic, but at the same time, it's intoxicating. Bringing some level of perverse satisfaction. It may be that your marriage isn't satisfying. You don't spend quality time of communication and love and interaction with your spouse, with your husband and wife. So you become subject to a Jezebel spirit because you're not under your husband's covering and oversight. Question is, are you willing to deal with the spirit of Jezebel? I'm going to war against it. Our staff is going to war against it. But I have to solicit you. The battle is in the trenches of where people live. I want us all standing. And I want to make this altar available to everyone here today. Judge it, deal with it, reject it, repent of it. This is a very sacred altar call, I believe. I've thought about this sermon more than any other sermon that I preached recently, prayed over it longer and more than any other message recently ministered. I want you to begin to pray. If you need to repent of the Jezebel spirit, there are wives and husbands here. You recognize it's in your home. It's in your marriage. How many of you wives or husbands have stirred up your spouse to think in ways that are not of God, to do things that are not of God? You go off. This was Jezebel. She went off and on and off and on and on and on and on and on. God, I want to be free from this. I want to be clean. This is a subtle spirit that knows how to navigate its way onto a throne of Israel, of all places. It knows how to navigate its way into a position of authority in the church, where people recognize the individual as someone who can teach and has authority to defy the ministry, the God-ordained ministry that God has given us. Oh God, I pray right now for discernment among the righteous. Give us discernment, Lord. I reject the spirit of Jezebel from my own heart. Any vestige of it, however small, in any small way it may be expressing itself in my life, I reject the spirit of Jezebel from my life. And Lord, I want to commit myself to be an instrument that can judge its presence in our church, gently but firmly pushing back on this spirit when I see it operating in someone's life. Oh, God, I praise you for your cleansing power to be at work right now over this altar, washing and cleansing your church from every unclean spirit of Jezebel, from our hearts, from our relationships, from our membership. Lord, let the cleansing power that is in the blood of Jesus wash over this sanctuary here today, every heart and every life. Oh, riala ra vila ra ba sho, riala ra vila ra ba koria, yende re ala ra vila ra ba ka, riala ra vila ra ba sho, riala ra vila ra ba koria, yende re ala ra vila ra ba koria. Father, touch every heart. Let your spirit be manifest, your spirit of righteousness and holiness. Father, the cleansing power that is in your precious blood, detaching from us every spirit and attitude, thought and imagination that is contrary to faith, obedience, love, and surrender. I cast out every spirit of rebellion, every defying demon spirit that contends and chafes against your authority from having expression in the church. I take authority over every expression of sexuality in the public arena. Lord, give our women a spirit of modesty and conviction and discernment about what is appropriate. Oh, riala ra vila ra ba sha, riala ra vila ra ba koria, yende re ala ra vila ra ba sha, riala ra mando ro lo ro bo sa la ra mande, yende re ala ra vila ra ba ka, riala ra vila ra ba sho, riala ra vila ra manda. Father, I thank you, I praise you, I love you, I exalt you, I glorify you. Oh God, let holiness prevail, righteousness prevail. We're serving notice. I am serving notice as your pastor. We are serving notice together that the spirit of Jezebel has been exposed and identified. Now we can do something about its presence in our midst. I want you all to stand with me at the altar. You watch the difference when we gather together tonight. I'm not saying it's all going away and evaporating, she'll fight back, but a lot's been accomplished here today. You watch the difference in the service tonight. It's gonna feel different. I preach revivals where service after service from Saturday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, progressively the spiritual dimension begins to shift. I feel that a lot when I preach in revivals and conferences sometimes. Sometimes over at church there's a heaviness, there's a cloud of oppression. And if I can get the mind of God and preach the right sermon, God can break that. And I believe something's broken here today. Amen. I want you to bow your heads. There are women here. God's dealing with you. You see some of what I preached in your heart. It may be how you were raised. It may be how you have been mothered, the kind of friends you have had, the kind of betrayals and wounds that you've experienced in your life. Life can make a Jezebel out of someone. You're rebellious, unsurrendered, unsubmitted. The only way you know how to gain attention is to project yourself sexually. There are men here, same spirit of rebellion. We need to recognize it and not leave here. We need to leave this behind at the altar. I want you to pray with me right now. God in heaven, I thank you for the revelation of truth about this Jezebel spirit. I recognize it. I can see it operating in our church, in my life, and around me. And Lord, I want deliverance. I confess its presence, and I repent of it, and I'm sending it away. No more rebellion, no more allowing myself to be subjugated by the spirit of Jezebel. And when I see it operating around me, lovingly but firmly, I am pushing back. I am not going to allow Jezebel to intimidate me, to cause me to isolate myself, and to demoralize me. I'm standing against her with the confidence of God, and I'm pushing back, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world, and more there are that be with me than they that be with them. Energize me, empower me with the Holy Ghost. Cleanse our church, cleanse our families, cleanse our ministries, cleanse our lives, O God, from the spirit of Jezebel. And we claim liberty right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's thank God today. Hallelujah. Father, you're worthy to be praised. You're worthy to be glorified. You're worthy to be exalted. Your name is above every name. Yendere ala ravila rabakari ala ravila rabashoria. Yendere ala ravila rabakari ala ravila rabakoria. Yendere ala ravila rabarobo rabala ravila ramando. Yendere ala ravila rabashoria ala ravila ramando ro. Yendere ala ravila rabakori ala ravila ramando.
Unto recovery, unto deliverance, but know this of a certainty,
that I will judge this spirit and those who are of this spirit who will not repent. I will judge in order to protect my church and my purpose and my will, saith the Lord. Glory to God. Yendere ala ravila raba shori ala ravila raba koria yendere ala ravila ramando rodo robo raba la ramando rodo robo se. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's bow our heads right where we are. You never know what's going to happen when we gather together, come to church. God certainly does have an agenda for every service, and I want to really encourage you to be back tonight. And open your heart and let's you watch the difference of the spiritual dimension we're going to sense in our congregation. Bring someone that needs Jesus. I believe there's going to be great liberty to preach, see people saved. We saw a number of people here prayed to receive Jesus this morning. We thank God for that. But let's gather together tonight expecting and believing God for great things. And we're preaching that message entitled Transformation at the Potter's House from Jeremiah 18, so you don't want to miss that. Let's bow our heads. I'm going to ask if Juan Vaquero would close our service in prayer. You go rejoicing, take time to bless and minister to one another as we dismiss. Amen. God bless you. Go rejoicing. Love one another as you're dismissed, and we'll see you tonight.